everyone to the annual October presentation of the Tantramar Unexplained Society. My name is Dr. Sue Lawrence, and it's a pleasure to see so many living people here, as well as the spirits who I'm sure are filling the empty seats. As you know, each year preceding the celebration of All Hallows Eve, the Society presents a dramatic presentation of some of our local area's most chilling stories. This region certainly has its fair share of spine-tingling tales passed down around kitchen tables, around campfires, and even in candlelit dorm rooms. Many of us are familiar with local lore like the Lavender Lady, a heartbroken mother in a house on Bridge Street who is never seen, but whose lavender perfume can be scented when she's present. Or the imperious ghost of Ethel Peak, a Mount Allison opera professor who is said to haunt Hart Hall decades after she left the earthly stage. And of course, in Amherst, the possession of Esther Cox has captivated people for over a century. Tonight, then, we present three tales of Tantramar terror for your education and your entertainment, of course. Pulled from our archives and dramatized for the first time, you may have heard some of these stories before, or they may be new to you. Either way, we hope they will continue to stay with you long after our humble presentation has concluded. Our first story takes place at the Middle Sackville Superior School, or what is more commonly known today as the Old Schoolhouse. In fact, the street is now known as School Lane. It operated as a school until 1954, and eventually the old classrooms were rented out to local artists. This scene took place in the fall of 1997, when a group of Mount Allison theater students were using one of the classroom studios as the base for their production. Please enjoy our first tale entitled, Don't Open the Door.
Because Third Eye Blind sucks.
Hey! Sorry, they're not sad, sad, super sad music like whatever you play on your show on CHMA.
Okay.
Oh my god, I'm not sticking around this place all night if you guys are going to argue about music. Is there any more stuff to come in?
Did someone get the riser?
Yeah, I grabbed it earlier. It's over there.
Cool, then I think that's everything.
Schooner, anyone?
Yeah.
Damn, you guys brought a lot of beer just for pre-drinking.
Oh, we decided to skip the pub and just bring it.
What? No. No, we can't do that.
Why not?
Well, Ian's DJing, so.
So? He always is.
Okay, but we should really go. It'll be fun. Everyone's gonna be there.
Yeah, that's why we want to stay here.
We can't stay here.
Why not? There's no one else here. It's not like there's going to be noise complaints.
Yeah, Jen, it's just us. No one else is coming by except Dennis and Claudine later.
No, we can't stay here.
Why not?
We just can't.
What? Is it haunted?
Jen?
I mean, kinda.
Oh, whatever. You just want us to go to the pub in case Devin's there.
No, Devin's gross.
Since when? Last week you were all Devin all the time.
Yeah, what happened?
Nothing. Honest. Okay, so maybe he's not gross, but his apartment definitely is.
Oh yeah, it really is.
Wait, get back to the ghosts.
Yeah, what's the deal?
You guys are just gonna make fun of me.
No, seriously, is there a ghost here?
Ghosts.
Whoa!
Cool!
Tell us!
We should really just go to the pub.
No, tell us the story first, and then maybe we'll go.
Maybe, come on. If you got a story, tell it. Tell it!
It's fine. Okay, here goes. So, this is an old schoolhouse, right? Well, it's haunted by the ghosts of 11 children and a man named Clarence, who claims to have a child here but doesn't.
No, 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 no.
That's specific.
It's true.
No, 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 no.
How do you know that?
Yeah.
The previous tenants told us.
Right.
I'm sure they were just trying to scare you.
No, they actually said it was kind of a warning, like, just so you know.
What, they said it was 11 children.
Yeah, and they showed us the kids' names.
Okay, I'm out of here.
No, come on.
How did they know that?
I'm not sure. I think they did, like, a Ouija board thing one night or something.
Okay, so whatever.
Yeah, they might as well have played Connect Four at a birthday party.
Yeah, I know, but they left the list of names. And we laughed about it at first, but when weird stuff started happening, we decided to check it out.
Check what out?
Well, all the old school records are still in the attic.
What weird stuff?
The attic?
Yeah, they're still up there. So, one day we went up and we went through them, and all the names on the list are there in the books.
Okay, but, I mean, anyone can come up with Sackville names. Were any of them Henry Estabrooks? Gregory Hicks? Crystal Trenum?
Steve Sackville?
Terrible!
You guys can laugh, but you didn't see it. And you haven't seen what happens here after dark, so we should really go.
No, we should stay here and tell ghost stories. Besides, Dennis and Claudine are coming by, remember?
Yeah, let's stick around for a little bit at least. Yeah. We got beer that's already baked for.
Ghost stories it is.
Fine.
Just chillax. Alright, who's going first? Who's got a good ghost story?
Oh, well, when I lived in the Anchorage, there was definitely a ghost in there.
Oh, that's the place on York Street, right?
Yeah, and it's beautiful, but spooky in general. Like, I didn't like being alone in there. Okay, so when I was moving in, someone told me about the ghost of Mrs. Bennett. She was the wife of one of the old owners of the house before it became a part of the university. Apparently, both of her sons were killed in World War II, and she just eternally walks up the stairs, checking their rooms to see if they've returned.
That's so sad.
Yeah. And so scary when you hear the footsteps.
You actually heard them?
Yeah, a bunch of times. I've never seen her though, but still.
That's a bit like the Lavender Lady house on Bridge Street, right next to Joan's funeral home. Apparently there was a woman there like 100 years ago who spent all of her time caring for her sick son, but he still died. And since then, any little kid that grows up in the house claims to have been cared for by an old Victorian woman that smells like lavender perfume. Hence why they call it the Lavender Lady House.
Why is every ghost Victorian?
It's true!
Like, every ghost is in a long Victorian gown. Or it's spooky old piano music coming from somewhere. Where are all the 70s disco ghosts?
Maybe it takes time. Maybe in the future, people will sit around on Halloween telling ghost stories that end with, and then the grunge music was coming from inside the house!
I think Kurt Cobain's a very spooky ghost.
Too soon.
Jacob, your turn.
Oh, I don't have any ghost stories.
Lame!
Super lame!
Okay, well, I did have the same nightmare twice in one night, though. It was really weird. It was sometime in the future, and we were filming a TV version of a Shakespeare play.
Which one?
Well, the rehearsals weren't really part of the dream, so I don't know. But there were a lot of famous actors in it. But they weren't, like, famous yet, if that makes sense. Like, I could tell it was a big cast, but I didn't know any of them were. Anyways, we were in this super old TV studio for some reason, and we just finished a take, and we're all standing around, and then suddenly there was this, This frantic pounding on a stage door. Like someone desperately pounding to get in. And the crew looks around, and they're like, there's nothing behind that door.
Like, it was a part of the set?
No, more like it had been blocked up years ago, and it didn't open anything. So there's no way anyone could be on the other side. But this frantic, desperate pounding's still going. So someone goes to open it. And the crew's like, no, don't open the door. But they open it anyways. And this shape comes out. This black shape covers everything. And I woke up.
So like a creature or like a cloud?
Just sort of darkness coming out at a fast speed and covering everything. I don't know how to explain it.
Yeah.
So I was obviously pretty freaked out. But I eventually got back to sleep, and then the same dream starts again. Like, exactly the same dream. Except this time, I remember what happened from the first time. And again, someone goes to open the door. But now I'm with the crew. I'm like, no, don't open the door. But they go to open it anyways, and then, well...
Oh my god.
I told you!
What? What happened?
There was a little girl there, a ghost girl.
Oh, right. Yeah, way harsh, guys. Sorry to have an actual ghost story.
No, really? We just saw a ghost.
Oh, so you guys all had a ghost story, and I didn't. Now you all see a ghost and I don't? It's just great. Maybe she's still there.
Get out of the door!
I need to hear.
I need to... So ghosts get the party started, huh?
Now, can we please go to the pub?
I need a beer right now.
It was a girl. It was a little girl.
Are you okay, Kat?
No, I don't think I am. Jen, do you know what happened to the other children? The ghosts.
They said it was a fire, but I mean, I don't really see how that's possible. This building didn't burn down, obviously.
What about the other guy? What was his name?
Yeah, Clarence. I don't know. Nobody knew who he was or why he was here.
A teacher, maybe? Did she find his name in the records?
No.
We could check. As if I'm going to the attic now. There's no one out there. I looked, remember? Maybe you guys imagined it.
All of us.
We were telling ghost stories. Are you even sure you all saw the same thing? Girl about yay high?
In a frilly dress.
She stuck out her tongue?
Yeah, we all sure did. Okay. Well, whatever you saw, it's gone. There's nothing out there. I'm sure.
No.
Don't open the door!
God, they're just garlic fingers.
I'm just saying, guys, it's super scary out here.
Oh my god, we're super scared in here!
We saw ghosts like a few minutes ago.
Not all of us.
I definitely did.
Me too.
Wait. This place is actually haunted? Let's go to the pub.
Whoa, I want to see a ghost.
I've seen enough now.
Oh. Can you make it come back? Come back, ghost. We've got Joey's. Three cans of Pepsi. Yeah.
Stop it.
So you guys really saw a ghost. What did it look like?
It was a little girl. She stuck her tongue out at us.
Weird.
And there's more, right, Jen? What was the story?
Yeah, it was 11 ghost children.
11?
And a man named Chris.
Clarence.
Who claims to have a child here, but doesn't.
Creepy.
That's the first time I've seen one. They must really be mad.
Mad?
Yeah, the previous tenants told us that nighttime is their playtime, and if someone's here, they get mad and want us to leave. Essentially, you just get a really uncomfortable feeling, but sometimes they can use their energy to push stuff off the shelves.
Has that ever happened to you?
Yeah, once. I had a mug over there and it just fell off and smashed suddenly.
No.
Yeah.
Okay, so why are we here if they don't want us here? Let's get out of here and go to the pub.
No way, I want to see a ghost. And I've still got beer.
You okay, Karen?
No. I can't believe you guys are laughing about what I just saw.
Well, I saw her too, Karen. Well, it's just... it's so sad. That little girl, whatever happened to her, she never got to grow up. She's just here forever, you know?
Yeah, I know.
Like, she's a ghost. She had to have been alive. Every ghost is of someone. Someone who lived and had a family and friends and things they loved. Mrs. Bennett at the Anchorage, that was a real person. Ethel Peak was a real person. Kurt Cobain was a real person. That little girl had parents who must have cried about losing her for the rest of their lives. We can tell ghost stories at Halloween for fun and to scare each other, but if they're real, then they were real people.
You're right. It's okay.
So you guys really saw something?
Yes, definitely.
They did, anyways.
And there's no one else here?
No.
This light was the only one on when we came in. Man, I'm sorry we missed all the excitement.
What just happened?
I didn't touch it.
It just jumped off the shelf!
What?
Okay, they must really be mad.
The ghost did that?
Yeah.
Just, way cool.
We should go to the club. Let me clean that up.
I can't believe it.
What next?
Don't open the door. Dennis, you get it.
No! Don't open it!
No way, I want to see.
Sorry to scare you, kids. Everything okay? I heard something smash.
Oh, yeah, it was just a glass.
Well, I've got my broom and dustpan. I'll clear that up for you.
Oh. Thank you.
Guess you kids must be on the edge because it's Halloween, eh?
Yeah, you could say that.
Who is that? I don't know.
I'm sorry. Who are you? I didn't know there was anyone else here.
Oh, don't mind me. I just clean up around here.
He looks real.
If I were you folks, though, I'd be thinking about calling it a night soon. It gets awfully cold in here at this time.
Have you ever seen anything strange around here at night?
Just being in an old schoolhouse at night is strange enough, is it?
Good point.
Yep, I've spent a lot of time here. There's a lot to look after. A lot to look after.
Can I ask, did you go here when it was a school?
Yeah, I did. Many years ago. Such a long time ago now. All these classrooms were busy and full of life.
Did your kids go ahead too?
Oh, no, no. I never had any children. My wife passed away very young. Too young.
I'm so sorry.
It was a long time ago now. They didn't have the good hospitals we have nowadays.
Was she sick?
No, no. She was having our baby, you see. But things went wrong, and I lost them both.
I am so sorry. We shouldn't have asked.
Clarence?
Yeah.
Are the children here okay?
Yeah. Yeah. I look after them as I would of my own. Well, I got that cleared up for you, so I'll say goodnight. Don't hang around too long. I don't want the class to clean up any more of your mess.
Well, he was nice.
How did you know his name?
Oh my God!
A man named Clarence who claims to have a child here, but doesn't.
He doesn't because the child was never born.
What's going on?
So, we just talked to a ghost?
What?
Where else could he have come from? There's no one else here.
That man was definitely real.
Okay. I did. definitely think we should go to the pub. We could leave the beer here. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You okay, Karen?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm good. They're okay. They're loved.
The ghost?
Yeah. Yeah, let's go. Let's go and let them play.
Are we walking?
Claudine's driving. We can all fit in.
It will be tight.
To the ghost mobile!
I heard Devin's costume is amazing. Hi,
Make sure you got everything, guys. Don't be back here early tomorrow.
Oh, wait, my CDs. Hang on a minute, guys. Come on, guys, not funny. Guys?
There is a connection between ghosts and music, and it's not only stories of spooky piano music coming from an empty downstairs parlor, as one of our college students mentioned. Music's universality and connection to our emotions make it an important method of communication with the spirit world. Here in the Maritimes, our strong musical and folklore traditions mean the two are often intertwined. It's no coincidence that the legendary folklore collector, Helen Creighton's best known book, is Blue Nose Ghosts. That's why, for our next tale, we bring you a sinister story of musical mischief that dates from the 1940s, which we know from a surviving account by a Mr. Hazen Patterson of Spring Hill. Please enjoy the tale of the Phantom Fiddler of Frosty Hollow.
Matches there. Look at this place. Not much to look at.
Reckon it was nice enough once?
Don't matter now.
No, I guess not. But it would have been a lot nicer at the hotel, though. Why'd you have to say that to the manager?
Are you taking the side of that old fool?
No, Jack, but I don't understand.
Listen, if a man travels 30 miles from Spring Hill after a long day's work, he's earned the right to his whiskey. And conversation. And I don't converse unless I cuss or spit.
Well, that's the truth.
Oh, come on. But the money that we'll be saving by enjoying the hospitality of this old house, we'll be able to enjoy a few extra glasses when we get to St. John.
Okay, Jack, but you can't be drinking and cussing while we're staying with my sister in St. John. Do whatever you want to do down by the port. But she's been very generous in letting us stay with her. She doesn't deserve to be disturbed by your conviviality.
Disturbed by my conviviality, as you put it, might just be my aim.
You put a stop to that right now, Jack Murray. My sister is a good Christian woman. Let that be the end of it.
Who's to say that me would be the end of your sister being a good Christian woman?
You dog.
Whoa. Easy there, isn't easy. I'm just teasing you. I'll be leaving your sister alone, don't you worry.
She can take your word for it. But I never know with you.
Don't you trust me? After all these years down in the mines.
Mines are different.
How so?
There ain't no woman down in the mine.
Telling me.
Down in the mine, we're brothers. But up here, I have a sister to worry about. A good Christian woman, you hear?
Yes, Lillian's a good Christian woman. It's all over town. And I won't be bothering her, don't worry. Where's my whiskey gone to, anyways?
Put in your pack while you're being ushered out of the hotel.
Hey, good lad. Jeez, would you just look at this place? Looks like nobody's lived here for years.
Yeah, it's about 10 years.
And how would you know that? Did you measure the layers of dust, or did God whisper it into your ear because you're so pious?
I read the date on the newspaper.
Oh. Well, I'll be damned.
You will be if you keep cussing.
Wouldn't bother me.
How could you say that, Jack?
Listen, whoever lived here left in some hurry.
Yeah, sure seems like it.
I mean, what could just make somebody up and leave like that anyways? What kind of commotion could even happen in a place like... Wait. Where are we again? Are we still in Sackville?
The sign we passed on the road just now said Frosty Hollow.
Ah, Frosty Holler. I like it.
Frosty Hollow.
That's what I said. Frosty Holler. It's lonely and cold as hell. Not even any women around to keep me warm.
Just this whiskey, thank the devil.
Oh, keep the devil out of here. I want nothing to do with him.
Oh, no, not you, Hazen. When are you gonna start being fun?
What?
Having fun. I meant having fun. Come on, live a little, lad.
You know I have lots of fun. I go apple picking, I play in the church picnics. Remember when I came second place in the duck calling competition last year?
Who could forget?
It may not be your idea of fun, Jack, but not everybody shares your idea of fun. Especially not my sister.
Yes, your sister, the good Christian woman. Jesus save her. And the devil save me from this conversing. Hey, now that's something. Wonder what old tunes are hidden in this fiddle.
Sure seems old enough.
Yeah, not a bad looking fiddle by the looks of her, but I'm sure she don't sound like much. Let's see. Hey, ain't this fun, Hazen? Don't this sound like a hymn?
For the love of God, stop it.
Oh, I'm just, you know, I'm taken by the beauty of all creation and raising my voice to the Lord.
Stop it, stop it.
All right, I'm just teasing you. Not much of a fiddle after all. I mean, I'm the best fiddler in Cumberland County, and I couldn't even make her sing. I'm sure not even the devil himself can make a dance.
Stop talking that way, Jack.
Listen, don't tell me what to say. No teacher, preacher, hotel manager, or pious miner can tell Jack Murray what he can and cannot say. If I want whiskey, I'll drink whiskey. And if I want to cuss, it's time to cuss. And if I want to play music, I'll play whatever chinks and reels I want. Now come on, lighten up a little bit, would ya?
Surprised. I guess all her jumping about knocked it off.
Yeah, that's it. Or maybe that old beau knows a good tune when she hears one and she wanted up on the dance floor too.
Play another one, Jack. It takes the cold out of this old place.
All right, how about the River Hibbert Reel? Just let me get a quick drink.
What?
That was the River Hibbert Reel, all right. First three notes at least.
You're playing some kind of trick on me, aren't you?
Tricks be damned. I'll show that old fiddle how it goes. How's about that?
Jack, let's get out of this place now.
I'll not. I'd recognize that fiddling style anywheres. How are you, Eb?
What?
Oh, that's definitely the plan of my old pal, Ebby Dill.
Jack.
Come on, Eb, show yourself.
Ebby Dill?
That's right. Finest fiddler I ever heard. Second finest in Spring Hill, mind you.
Jack, Ebby Dill disappeared 10 years ago.
You don't think I don't know that? You must be thick.
Well, then how can he...
Blazes, I don't know. You're the religious one. But I'd recognize that sound anywheres.
Don't be foolish. Let's get out of here.
You didn't know him. I did. Come on, Em. Stop on the floor once if it's you.
How can we play fiddle this queer old house in Frosty Hollow?
Of course.
Of course what?
Ed went missing after a show in Sackville. That's right. Is that what happened, Em? Did you get in trouble with an old woman down this way? There never was a skirt between Campbellton and Cape Breton you didn't chase like an old hound. Woof, woof! Come on, give us a stop.
Are you sure it was Sackville?
Oh, I'm sure of it. It was in all the papers.
What if it's not him?
Hazen, why don't you just sit down and, I don't know, have a drink or say a prayer?
Come on, Ed. How about me and you play the coal miner's reel?
Mr. Dill, known as a fill-in miner, was last seen playing a harvest dance in Sackville, Nova Scotia.
Sackville, Nova Scotia? Lower Sackville? So not Sackville, New Brunswick. Well, why are there two Sackvilles anyways? It don't make no sense. Wait, then who have I been fiddling against?
What?
I'll be damned. The devil himself has graced the stage.
Jack, let's get out of here.
Did you challenge Ebby Dill, Satan? That's what I thought. Some fine fight you picked there.
Jack, let's get out of this infernal place now.
Nah. You may have gotten the best of Ebby Dill, Satan, but you're messing with Jack Murray now, and Jack Murray's fiddle don't come second to no one. Not even the devil.
Jack, think of your salvation.
Run along, Hazen, if you can't stomach it. Run along to St. John with your good Christian sister. I found a good old time right here. Come on, Satan, call the tune. Tonight, the devil and I will be melting Frosty Hollow.
Tonight have had their own encounters with ghosts, but has anyone here seen a witch? I'm not referring to the witch costume that a child might wear as a trick-or-treating costume with the broomstick and the hat. In fact, even if you have seen a witch, it's quite possible that you wouldn't know. After all, the idea of witchcraft varies from culture to culture, from region to region, and across the ages of time. Like ghost stories, magic and witches are universal. But witchcraft has also been the pretense for persecution. You're no doubt familiar with the Salem witch trials, but there have been similar prosecutions closer to home. On the present day grounds of Fort Beausejour, in fact. In 1684, a man named Jean Campagnard stood trial there for witchcraft. The court records show he kept a sense of humor during the trial when a witness testified that witchcraft had caused his crops to fail. Campagnard replied, "He doesn't need magic to be a terrible farmer." He was acquitted and no further mention of him is found in the record. Given all that's at stake, then it's possible that if you did encounter a witch, you might not return to tell anyone about it. So take heart and comfort that our next performance is just that, a performance. Though once you become acquainted with the legendary Marsh Witch of the Tantramar, you may find yourself sticking to well-lit roads instead of any shortcuts at night.
So, have you been watching the show The Pawn on Netflix?
Huh? What?
Well, you know, it's the one with, what's her name? She was in that show.
I'm sorry, I'm just, you know, trying to stay focused on the job here is all.
Oh, sure.
Like, I've never seen something like that before.
Oh, I know, right? And the supporting cast is amazing.
No, I meant over there.
Yeah, I guess you haven't seen much of that, huh?
Not like that.
Listen, it's not easy, but you get used to it. Oh, okay, we're good to go? All right, let's light her up. My husband's huge into football.
How long have you been doing this?
Chatting? Since before I could walk. My granny says that I...
No, I meant driving the ambulance. This way.
Oh. About 14 years, I think? I was living in the Blue House on Belmont Street after college, but it was before I moved in with Bryce, or was it when we were in the apartment on Willow Street? Let me think.
Have you ever seen anything weird?
Every day.
Out here?
What? Here on the marsh? Not really. There's nobody out here.
Nobody out here.
It's just a lot of wind between Sackville and Amherst, really. Unless you count the big stop, I guess. Last week, I pulled in there.
Have you ever seen any lights?
Lights on the marsh?
Yeah.
No. Well, there used to be these great big CDC towers, great tall things with red lights on them. You always knew you were getting close to home when you saw them, but they tore those down about 10 years ago now, long before you showed up.
I've heard about them, yeah.
They're really spooky in the fog some nights, but other than that, lights, no. Just other cars passing on the highway. Why?
Just some of the time when I've been driving, I've seen lights out on the marsh. I thought it was farmers at first, but yeah, I don't know. It didn't seem like tractor lights or anything.
What do you know about tractors, Mr. Toronto?
I know what vehicle lights look like.
I'm just teasing you. I don't know. What did they look like? Fireflies?
No, they weren't like that. It was more like one light just sort of bobbing?
Bobbing, eh?
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe you've seen the Marsh Witch. All right, we're here. Let's get this guy processed and get on our way. I've got 3 more episodes of The Pawn and a jumbo bag of popcorn waiting for me at home.
Welcome to the Mysterious Maritimes podcast. In this episode, we explore the legend of the Marsh Witch of the Tantramar. Who is she and what is her story? Does she still stalk the borderlands between New Brunswick and Nova Scotia? Join us as we examine this centuries-old tale. I'm David Callahan, Jones. At first glance, the Tantramar Marsh outside of Sackville, New Brunswick appears to be a place of great natural beauty. With its swaying cattails, mudflats, and flocks of migratory birds, it's a unique ecosystem that sits between the powerful tides of the Bay of Fundy and warm coastal water of the Northumberland Strait. And yet, there is something entirely unnatural about it. It exists in its current state because of man-made changes to the landscape that began 400 years ago with the arrival of settlers from France. Settlers who would meet a tragedy of their own. And the land's beauty can't conceal an eerie air of desolation. It's often heightened by the frequent Funday fog that drifts over it, and the strong winds that bend every tree into a twisted shape. And then, there are the lights.
Here's your coffee. You left your strudel at the counter.
That's Sorry. Thanks, Ron.
What are you listening to?
Oh, it's just a podcast. It's a sort of spooky mystery thing.
Cool.
Hey, Rowan. You've lived here for a while. Have you ever seen anything scary?
Yeah, karaoke night at Larry's.
No, I meant more like out on the marsh.
No, I don't go out there as much. Why have you?
No. Oh, the podcast just sort of has me in the mood to ask is all.
You should ask Theodore. He's a photographer. He's probably spent more time in the marsh than just about anyone. Hey, Theodore, have you seen anything weird on the marsh?
I'm sorry?
Oh, Robert's asking if you've seen anything weird on the marsh. I gotta get back to cash.
Hi, my name's Robert.
Theodore, what's your question exactly?
I was just wondering if when you've been out on the marsh, you've seen anything sort of unusual, like something you couldn't explain.
Something paranormal?
Yes!
No, I haven't seen anything like that.
No strange mists or strange lights or anything?
Well, fog is very common here, so that's not strange. But lights, you mean like orbs of light?
Yes, like a ball of light that's floating along like it's being carried in someone's lantern, but way too smooth for any person to be carrying.
Oh, I think what you're seeing is a jack-o'-lantern.
No, this wasn't a pumpkin. This was out on the marsh.
Oh, not that kind of jack-o'-lantern. What I meant is a will-o'-the-wisp, also called a jack-o'-lantern. It's a light phenomenon that people have been talking about for centuries, usually seen in bogs and marshes.
Okay, interesting.
It's said to resemble a lamp, and sometimes if you move away from it or towards it, it comes towards you as well. Folklore says that it's probably primeval spirits or fairies luring unsuspecting people from safe pathways deeper into the swamp.
And you've seen these?
No, I haven't, but a friend of mine from Newfoundland said he saw it. What he said he saw was a lamp, as he described it, moving about in the wetlands near his cottage. He went out to have a look, and suddenly it came towards him and became larger. He panicked, threw a rock at it, and ran back to his place.
Wow.
His neighbors said it was a wandering spirit, or perhaps a fairy of some sort, and warned him never to follow one again. They certainly believe the folklore, but what it actually is bioluminescence, sometimes known as foxfire.
I'm sorry, what does that mean?
Well, it's a naturally occurring phenomenon where a gas is released from decaying vegetative matter, vegetables, animals, that sort of thing.
Oh.
So, you're probably not seeing a ghost, or a witch, more like a sort of light after death. Nice to meet you, Robert.
A dark local legend from the town of Amherst, Nova Scotia provides one potential origin for the Marsh Witch. The details differ with each telling, but the horrifying tale has a few constants. An Amherst farm girl was lured to a barn, most likely on present-day Foundry Street. In some tellings, farmhands called for her to come care for a newborn calf. In some, she was lured by a group of railway men. In every version, the incident results in her pregnancy, and further grim details follow. The baby would be lost, and the girl would die as well. And so the spirit of the innocent, dressed in a pure white dress, is said to search the marsh for her child forever.
We were told.
Yeah? What did you hear?
God, I can't believe I'm talking about the Marsh Witch again. I don't even remember the last time I heard anyone talking about it.
Really?
Yeah. It's just this thing we do as kids. We go down to the marsh at the bend at the end of Russell Street and we hide in the grass and then we chant, Marsh Witch, where are you? That was supposed to make her appear. Honestly, I think the idea of kids hiding in the grass chanting that would have been scarier for someone to come across than the Marsh Witch herself.
So she never appeared, huh?
God, no. It's just a story the older folks would tell us. Probably to scare us from sneaking out at night. Although...
What?
I don't know if this is the same thing, but my Uncle Terry... Well, he wasn't really my uncle. He was more like my aunt's friend, if you know what I mean. Anyway, Uncle Terry used to drive for Amherst Taxi. And one night he says he picked up this girl in a white dress down on the old highway right by Drifter's Lounge. Okay, so you wouldn't know where that was, but you know the old highway? Like if you keep driving past Frenchie's? Anyway, he picks up this girl in a white dress. She gets in and doesn't say nothing. But he figures she's from the school for the deaf, which they used to have here, and felt kind of sorry for her, so he decided to take her back there. Well, he pulls up to the front doors, and he looks in the back seat, and she's gone. Vanished.
Huh?
Of course, nowadays, they call it the Center for the Hearing Impaired, but that's what they used to call it back then.
I mean, so, what, she just vanished? Like, did he ever see her again?
No, but he talked to the other cab drivers, and they all said the same thing happened to them. Some of them said she disappeared when they passed Foundry Street, but I don't know if that's the same thing as the Marsh Witch, or whether the Marsh Lights are her or what.
Wait, Marsh Lights? You've seen them?
No, but you said you did, and my dad used to talk about them all the time, too. I must just be too busy singing along with the radio to notice. Oh, speaking of which, witch, get it?
Got a fast car, got one ticket to anywhere. Maybe we make a gig.
Hello?
Is this Robert?
Yes. Who is this?
I understand you were looking for the Marsh Witch.
Yes. Who is this?
Be careful. It could be treacherous out in the marsh at night.
I know that. What do you know about the Marsh Witch?
I've seen her. She's real. That's all you need to know. Don't go trying to find her yourself.
I can't stop. I can't shake those lights.
Whatever reason you have, it's not good enough. Stop looking for her.
Why? What happens when I see her?
It's not whether you see her. It's whether she sees you.
What happens then?
Nobody knows.
It was the French settlers, known as the Acadians, who first built the dikes on the Tantramar Marsh that turned what had been salt marshes into farmland. Hundreds of barns dotted the fields that were now used to harvest hay and other crops that ensured their survival. But survive they did, until 1755. That would be the year of the Great Expulsion. The 7 Years' War between England and France crashed into the region with a British victory at Fort Beausejour. For the British, victory alone was not enough. The Acadians, they decided, must be deported. For Jean-Paul and Marie Latour in the Acadian village of Beaubassin, it meant one thing, hide. During a militia raid one night, Jean-Paul escaped out a back door, disappearing into the night. But when the coast was clear, Jean-Paul did not return. Night after night, Marie frantically searched the marsh by lantern light after dark, hoping to find her love. And then one night, she too never returned. It is said that it is her spirit wandering the marsh at night, lantern in hand and weeping as she searches, eternally, for the one she truly loved. Perhaps she, then, is the Marsh Witch? If, like me, you have trouble sleeping after stories like these, there's hope. An Endy mattress will help you sleep better than ever thanks to its patented...
Yeah, that's a load of crap.
What?
I mean, it's a great story, and I've heard it for years. You know, it's spooky, it's fun, but it's just a story, Rob.
Yeah, but there could be some truth to it.
Well, you know, the expulsion of the Acadians is true, of course, but...
Exactly.
But you can go and look at the monument to the town of Beaubassin. It's up on Fort Lawrence Road, right by the Tourist Bureau. But I'll save you the drive. There's nobody named Latour on it.
No?
No. I mean, there's a fistful of Cormiers, a bushel of Bourgeois, but, you know, nobody named Latour. It's not even really an Acadian name, Latour. You know how many Latours there are in the Moncton phone book? There's one, right before about 6,000 LeBlancs. I've looked all this stuff up before, Bob. You can look all of this up. I've researched all of this.
Okay, so what are you telling me?
I'm telling you, lay off the podcasts, man. Because you are getting way too into this stuff. I mean, I heard you were even asking, what's-his-face, Theodore about this?
Where did you hear that?
In line at the Independent, bud.
Oh, jeez.
It's just a legend, Rob. One that nobody even cares about. I mean, you know what people care about around here? Paying their rent, who's sleeping with who, and drive-thrus.
I need to know.
Why?
Because I keep seeing the light out on the marsh when I'm driving.
From the ambulance?
Yeah, and I need to know because it's just eating away at me.
Look, Rob, I get it, okay? I do. I first started collecting ghost stories and other paranormal stuff after I lost my mom. I needed a distraction, and maybe I needed to reassure myself that there's something more to the world than what we can see. I don't know, really. But is it possible, Rob, that maybe that's what you're looking for, too? I mean, look, every day you deal with death and loss and trauma, and your job is to make it all go away as quickly as possible, at least in a sense.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, I get why this is so compelling to you, but it's not good for you, man. It wasn't good for me. Just listen to something different, okay? Put all the books and stuff away, and whatever you do, don't go and, I don't know, spend the night out on the marsh or something, okay? Promise?
The tales of the Marsh Witch are not confined to the history books. In 1983, a truck driver reported an unsettling incident in the fog while passing the CBC shortwave towers. A fog that was nowhere to be found until he reached that exact stretch of highway. A fog, he later explained, that seemed to follow him and him alone.
Show you again.
I honestly can't see or hear much of anything, Rob. I think you just got startled.
Yeah, because I saw a witch.
Probably not.
I'm telling you.
Easy there, buddy. Calm down.
She was wearing a white dress, like the girl from the old highway.
Who was?
What are you even talking about?
I'm telling you, the Marsh Witch is real. She's real, or at the very least, someone is out there.
Rob, sit down. Take a minute. God's sakes, relax. How long have you been up, bud? I mean, when was the last time you slept?
I need to know.
There's nothing to know. It's a bunch of stories. Folklore.
Look, go home, okay? Do some laundry, take a shower, get some sleep, and then come over and we'll watch a movie, okay? A non-horror movie. We'll watch, What About Bob? You know, 1991, Bill Murray, Richard Dreyfuss, yeah. And you'll see that all of this witch stuff is just you being tired and burnt out.
But it's not. I know it's not.
Give me your phone.
Hey.
I'm deleting that stupid podcast that you've been obsessed with.
What?
And I'm putting our movie night into your calendar with an alarm, okay?
Okay.
Here. Want you a drink?
Thank you, Rowan.
What should I call it? A potion! Woo!
What are you doing, Robert? Come on. It's all in your head, like everyone says. I mean, you already had to leave Toronto once because of obsession. You can't do it again. Not in here. It's not healthy. Come on, Robert. Go home.
It's you. I suspected as much. You shouldn't be out here at this time of night, and definitely not standing here.
Thanks, but I'm good, okay?
I saw her once.
I knew it! I knew you would lie to me! When I asked you about the lights, you said it wasn't a witch, but I never mentioned her.
I did it to protect you. Obviously, that didn't work.
When did you see her?
It was on a night like this. Many decades ago, I glimpsed her light, and then I saw her, and all the breath went out of my body in that instant.
What did she look like?
Even in the distance, I could tell she was beautiful, and lonely, and cold, just like the marsh. It was as if she'd sucked up every inch of this murky quagmire and been made human. She came towards me. All the insects went quiet, and all I could feel was wind and chill and only fury from her.
But how?
I grabbed my shutter and began snapping, never taking my eyes off her. Suddenly, she moved towards me 50 feet in an instant. I turned and ran, never looked back.
Did you see her again?
I immediately went to my darkroom to develop the pictures I'd taken. There was nothing there. The most nothing I'd ever seen. It was as if the picture folded back into itself somehow.
Oh.
Over the next year, I came here hundreds of times, trying to take photos of her. It was a difficult time for me. I suffered a terrible loss, the worst kind of loss. I was angry, very angry.
But you're here, now.
Finally, I realized I didn't want to see her again, that she'd only come to me because of my rage. And though I still walk this ground, I thank God that I've never seen her. You should do the same, Robert. Take my advice. Whatever it is that's troubling you, you won't find the answer to it here. Let her be.
It was you that phoned me, wasn't it?
Don't be a fool! Go home and don't come back here!
So who is the Marsh Witch? Is she a grieving mother? A heartbroken lover? Or is the question, what is the Marsh Witch?
Marsh Witch, where are you? Marsh Witch, where are you? Oh my God! Wait, it's you. Hold on, why are you crying? I need to know. I need to know why you're crying. I need to know who you're looking for. Is it for your husband? Okay, is it for your lost child? Tell me, what made you the Marsh Witch?
You call me the Marsh Witch. I am no witch. I am the marsh.
Huh?
I am the body in which land and air and sea converge. Within me is creation and destruction. I transform and am transformed when I am left free to be in my nature. But men like you have not let me be.
No, I can see you. You're a woman in a bunny dress.
How you see me is of your own making, and make it you have. You have disfigured me in order to grow your crops and feed your cattle and enrich yourselves. I was more once. Now, this is what you've left me.
Just tell me, are you Marie Latour? Or are you that farm girl still searching for a child, or are you somebody else?
I am all of them.
What?
You seem to believe that all events happen but once, when in fact all stories told are told again, over and over through time, only superficial details that change. If a lost love caused a woman to search eternally by lamplight, do you really believe there would only be one woman to see? Do you believe that there is only one child conceived in violation, yet sorrowfully sought for by its mother? What a fool you must be. For there would be a million lamplights roaming this place for all of that pain, burning so bright the stars would be invisible. So yes, I am Marie Latour, and I am that farm girl. When you see me, you see them all. I am the Marsh. I am older than anything you can imagine. I have seen more than you can possibly conceive. I have absorbed all of the elements and witnessed the same cyclical tides. Over and over, you engrave the land in your own image, with little regard for those around you. Again and again, you mistreat others because of your selfishness and fear. The same mistakes made as predictably as the rising and falling of the pendulum.
Okay, but, I mean, what about joy, right? Like, you absorb that too, don't you?
Yes. I feel the warmth of the sunlight, and I rejoice in new growth. But at night, when all is dark, the tears return. And as you can see, my tears are tears of earth. When I weep for all the grief of women, the wetlands rise. When I weep for all the loss, the winds blow harder. And when I weep for my poor body, the nighttime chorus of insects join me. So you see, that is night for the Marsh. And you have made the mistake of seeking me at night.
Just let me go. Please, I'll go.
Go. No. I seek you. You came to me at this time, the time of my weeping. And it will not be long before all of my accumulated sorrow and tears rise up and drown everything you all have built. The mud will rise and bury this town, and it will once again be subsumed into me. Woe to all of them when that time comes. But for you, Robert, your time of transformation has come.
No! No! No!
No, I'm okay. I only worked a few shifts with him before he stopped showing up. I'll be fine. They said it was drowning in mud. I know, right? But here's the weird part, okay? They found it sitting up. Yeah, sitting right up. Ugh, drowning in mud. What a sin. That's what they told me. I just drive them. And anyway, I'll be back on the road right quick. Oh. Hey, listen, are you going to Wade's barbecue out at the shore on Saturday? Oh, great. Bryce and I will be there with the kids, too. Are you bringing anything? No, I hear you. But why don't you just stop at the superstore and grab a Deep and Delicious and some ice cream? Yeah, get vanilla. Nothing chocolate.
That concludes our presentation this evening. We hope you have enjoyed yourselves, perhaps learned a little, and maybe even felt a shiver or two. Perhaps some of these stories differed from how they were told to you. That's okay. The supernatural is malleable. It is not data to be entered, but magic to be experienced. Please join us again this time next year, but until then, take care, walk on well-lit roads, and when the marsh winds begin to howl, pray the power doesn't go.